be making the Give Me Morey Margarita. Now, I'm going to start by making a little bit more of a skinny margarita because quarantine's got me packing on a few and I'd like to get those off before show season starts. So start by putting ice in your shaker. Add 2 ounces of fresh squeezed lime juice, 2 ounces of Blanco tequila, 1 ounce of agave nectar. Give that a nice shake. Now I've already pre-salted my rim, so you're just gonna pour this directly into your glass. Finish by garnishing with a fresh squeezed lime. And there you have your Give Me Morey Margarita. Now I think I hear the phone ringing. Let's go see who it is. Andale!
Hey guys!
Hey,
happy Cinco de Mayo!
Yeah,
Thank you guys for joining us on this festive day. We are gonna play, before we get started with our interview, for our viewers, we're gonna play a little drinking game. So when any of us say this word on the bottom of the screen, beep, 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 I'm not gonna say what it is, everybody that's watching has to take a drink of their margarita.
Oh, okay.
Okay, all right. Okay. All right, well, thank you guys.
I've already drank most of mine right now, so this may not go very well.
Hey, that means it's gonna be even better. Well, I'm glad to see you guys. Stan, how are you feeling? You look good.
Doing good. So far, so good. Okay. Just glad to be here.
Good. Now, Stan, for the people watching that don't know what it is that you do, tell them a little bit. You're the Arabian Horse Association Judges Commissioner. Tell us a little bit about what you do.
My job was created in 1992, long ago, for to educate judges, monitor judges, and just kind of set up a schools, seminars, all those kind of things. So, and judges and stewards. I really don't do a lot of, I work a lot with USCF stewards, but they have their own criteria that they were learned from. But through the EEC and a couple of different commissions, while we establish a school and a seminar that they attend every year, and then it's up to me to go through that and monitor all of those things.
What do you like most about your job?
You know, I like all of it. I mean, there's parts of it that are unpleasant sometimes because of what judges may or may not do. And, you know, by the way, 99.9% of all judges are trying to do the right thing. But sometimes some other things get in the way or whatever. They've had a bad day. So, but most of the time, it's not. I always hear the word politics, and I always equate that. If you're going to say politics, why, does that mean you're lying to me? What is that?
Yeah. Fake anyway, news.
I look at that totally differently than a lot of people do. And I was one of the ones before that. So when I was out there riding a lot, I thought, yeah, that was politics. But most of the time, it's they're just doing the best they can with it.
Has your view changed a lot from being a trainer originally and then now in your role? What is your change of perspective there?
Total reversal. Not because I don't think that judges don't make mistakes, and I see that a lot. You know, I monitor judges, I talk about all those kind of things. But for the most part, when they're looking at a class, and most judges, at least in our breed, we have such a criteria that they go through, and if they're not going through steps, we can kind of tell that pretty fast. And it's so specialized now about what we do and what we're looking for with horses, either Western English Hunter, reining, all the pointing classes and time classes, whatever it is, they're all, I mean, most of those guys are all specialized in what they do. So.
Now, as part of the COVID relief committee, what do you think horse shows will look like when they start back up in the next few months?
Yeah, it's really interesting. Just today, we got most of the JLC got the guidelines out. We sent most of those as far as reopening barns because we're doing it in phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 type situations so that each state can look at that because they're all running in phases 2. And Cindy Meunier and all those guys that we worked with through the JLC have been really great to put this thing together. And again, it's in depth, but looking at it from the other side, when they crank that up, I mean, people are just going to have a little bit of patience, if you will, about what we're trying to do and what we have to do. You know, I don't think in any state out there, because every state's going to be different when they open it up, every state will be different about what they do. We've got to adhere to those deals. I mean, here in Oklahoma, we may be in phase 2 or phase 3 and they're still in phase one in New York or something. So it's all there. It's a lot different. And unfortunately, there is a, you know, I'll give you a statistic from my, just on my deal. From March 15th until May 1st, we had canceled 126 shows across the country. Okay, now some of those were USCF shows, some of them were value shows or not sanctioned shows. But when you start thinking about that and thinking about the mortgage industry or the saddle horse industry or all those other things that those people rely on those shows to go through, not just trainers, but vendors, everybody that was going through that. I mean, we've all suffered through that. So we're trying to get it up as fast as we can and get going, but I mean, you can only do so much. And if you go too fast, the worst thing that could happen to us, we jump out there and do something and we have an outbreak in a town or something like that, and it comes back to our fairgrounds or something like that. And that would kill the reeds.
Right, right. No, it's definitely universal. And that's what's so great about the JLC. The AHA is now working with the JLC. And in your opinion, what are some of the benefits of having an organization that represents all those trotting breeds?
Yes. Well, you know, I get a little bit aggravated with it because, not the JLC, but some of our, let's say our national organization, okay, USCF in some respects, it, sometimes it seems that they're thinking about hunter jumpers. I know they don't always just identify with that, but in the trotting breeds, we're talking about, to get this thing started specifically, how are you going to monitor a collective class? Okay, not just an individual class, because individual hunters go over, so it's a collective class. How are you going to monitor that? How are you going to do those things? How are you going to monitor the warm-up pen? Okay, about how are you going to do those things? So the JLC, we've kind of put things in place to look at those deals about how you go about doing that, and that's been a big help. It's not just Morgans, it's saddle horses, Hackneys, it's all the other breeds that are looking at it and trying to keep this thing in place and keep it going forward. There's a great group of people. Well, a little bit of a shout out to Kristen Cater. Okay. She did a great job kind of helping us organize, and so did Linda Freeset and all those guys that we worked with on the JLC, David Mount. I know I'm going to forget some of those people's names, but I really, really enjoyed working with them because it was a group effort to try to get this thing going, not just about their breed. It was about all of us trying to get something going.
Isn't it funny how when we're all so separate at a time like this, right, we almost feel more united than ever? And
very humbling to me, and I think to all of us. Here we go again. I mean, I would love to get some things going where we can all come together and start doing a lot of different things like that.
I would like that too. Now, you guys have had the best of both worlds. You had a very successful Arabian operation, and you gave that up for your position. And Susan, now you're running Hallmark Farms and are very successful in the Morgan world. How did you guys come to that decision? Because that couldn't have been an easy one to come to.
It was hard. But we waited until our daughter got out of junior exhibitor before we made that, because they had been on him for a few years to do this, and we wanted her to finish out her junior exhibitor career. And so when she went off to college, it was kind of a perfect chance for us to make that change. But it was hard. It was hard giving up. It's like a family. I've been doing that since 19.
She's been doing it forever.
Yeah, like 1969 or something like that.
I'm not sure Susan was born on a horse.
Yeah. So it was hard, but the Morgan breed, the Morgan people were wonderful. Yeah. I mean, they
great.
Were so, so welcome.
They are such a family, aren't they?
Oh, yeah.
Good people.
Mm-hmm. Now, what was the biggest difference for you from going to train Arabs to Morgans? What was the biggest training difference in just the two horses?
You know, I think Stan and I laugh about that because I love the Arabians, and I always will. Mm-hmm. And I think they're just great horses. But I think the Morgans, we found out, we laugh about this, they don't like to get in trouble. And where an Arab will get right back in your face, you know, not all of them, but, you know, anyway.
Yeah. Well, that too. And I think a couple of things. I mean, we had a big barn that had purebreds in it, but we were had a huge bunch of half Arabians that were half saddle horses. And so that kind of blended with us as far as what we were doing. But just by and large, the Morgans, all of them, we want to have good conformation, but I think the Morgan's conformation and his athletic ability just from years of breeding, inbreeding and doing all those kind of things, I think has helped him a lot for a little more sturdy horse from a frame standpoint.
We had talked about this. The Morgans were bred to trot and pull buggies. And the Arabians were bred to run across deserts and fight wars, and only the strong survived. And like Stan said, he goes, you got to teach a Morgan to canter. You got to teach an Arab how to trot.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's difficult.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you seem to know what you're doing. Stan, what's your favorite memory of Susan in the show ring?
You know, it's just going to sound funny, but I watched her one time win a half Arabian park class, national park class, with a horse that was as difficult to ride as anybody. I mean, this thing was difficult. And it wasn't that she was mean or anything like that. She was just tricky. And I watched her ride this class, and I mean, it was like, she just smoked this class. And I mean, she was unanimous and blah, 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 blah. And I was like, you know, how do you get that kind of timing? And so that was a neat trick.
You did good. You're lucky.
What he's not telling you is all the hours he put in there before to make me look good.
Yeah,
take the credit, Susan. No. Just take the credit, girl. Okay, God.
I said, you know, she still got to get it around the pen.
Yeah.
Okay, Susan, what's the most ridiculous way you've ever fallen off a horse?
You know, and this wasn't that long ago. I haven't been dumped in the, we were talking about this in like 30 years. I mean, I've had horses fall with me. I've gotten hung up in stirrups, but to actually be thrown, and it was literally probably one of the most broke horses in the barn. And I was jacking around with Mallory, and I was chasing her around and not paying attention. And this thing lawn darted me. I mean, boom. Yeah, it was quite embarrassing.
Now, what is your guys' least favorite barn chore? We all have one that we don't like, or more than one.
Water horses. I hate to water horses.
That's like the general consensus, I swear. Everybody hates to water.
Especially when it's cold.
If you guys had to pick one horse to ride, anybody's horses, which one would you want to catch ride?
I know, I saw,
and this is funny you mentioned, I saw a horse last year at the Arabian Nationals, Jimmy Stokowski had, that was kind of he was a renegade, but I mean, he hit three or four steps, and I was like, wow.
Do you know what his name was?
I can't remember his name, but I just remember that he was like a 3-year-old, and this thing, I mean, was like he was unbelievable.
Narrowing down a 3-year-old of Jimmy's will have take us some time. Yeah. We'll do it.
Well, that's what I always ask him. I go, do you know, don't you want to show or ride, you know, one of these? And he's not very often.
I think that's why this has worked out really well. I love training horses. I love working with horses. I love working with problem horses, you know. And I think because of the background with Arabs that, you know, because we had so many bad ones sometimes. Well, and we made them bad sometimes, and that was the other part that you got to be able to fess up to, that we did a real good job. I did a real good job of making them bad. So the point I'm making with that is that you learn, and I love looking at horses that are got quirks or, you know, different things, and try to work through those. So
how do you think your friends would describe you guys?
I can tell you how they describe him. I hear it all the time. Stan is such a nice guy. You have the most. Your husband is such a wonderful guy. Such a nice guy. I know there's people out there that probably don't agree with that.
No, there's a lot of people that don't agree.
Stan, how do they describe Susan?
Sometimes she's not Miss Congeniality. Doesn't go well sometimes.
Hey, I'm working for that sportsmanship award.
I kid her every year. I said, Susan, are you going to jump up this year at that sportsmanship? I don't think Yes.
I swore when Mallory won it, I said, they made a mistake. I think that was supposed to have been mine.
Yeah.
What is one thing you guys would like to cross off your bucket list?
Mine would be skydiving, and he won't let me.
No way.
Yeah.
Diving out of any plane.
What do you want to do, Stan, if not skydiving?
I'd like to drive a GT 500, 69.
Oh, okay. Anybody out there have a 69 GT? Give Stan a call.
There's a lot of them around. I mean, they've got two square pipes coming out of the back. They're cool.
All right, I'm going to keep my eye out for you. All right, if you guys had to evacuate your house right now, what three things would you grab?
Mine would probably be my national champion trophies. And, of course, my family pictures, all the family pictures and videos, and the dogs.
Yeah, I'm going to have to say that the dogs, my Western hats, and... you know, one thing, I have we have a picture of Susan and I being married. There's kind of in the three sets, sits on top of my desk at home, and I'd take that.
Oh, Stan. Yes.
Over your guns?
Over your guns?
Yeah.
Yeah. How long have you guys been married? What year did you get married?
1985.
Oh. Yeah. What's your secret?
We're old.
What do you guys have a secret to happy long marriage?
Stay away from each other as much as possible.
Well, you're sitting very close right now.
You know what? It's been we work together very, very well most of the time. Actually, we do better. We're better at working together than sometimes the marriage is. But that's what holds. I think that's what makes it work sometimes.
The best advice I ever got.
Yeah.
Was said if you got a problem. Wait 24 hours before you come back. Wait 24 hours. If you've got a problem and you've got an argument, you get a bitch, right? Wait 24 hours and then come talk. And that is the best advice. And we gave this to our children.
Yeah.
Lang's not married, but anyway. And he's the one when we got married told me that.
Oh, really? Well, it seems to be working for you guys.
That understands him. She's not the most patient person in the world.
I feel ya. Now, who's better to that stick into a budget?
She is.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Because he won't spend any money. He's so cheap.
I'm cheap.
I mean, he's so cheap.
Yeah.
He's so cheap. If anything breaks down, he will call the company and get it for free.
Hey, that seems resourceful.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's from being broke so often.
Now, what is one thing that makes you guys really uncomfortable?
Me is being in a crowd where people are around you real close.
Oh, well, good. You don't have to worry about that for a while.
Yeah, that's right. This doesn't bother me at all. Yeah.
Now, you guys have had some really incredible moments in your lifetime, but what is one moment that you wish you could relive again because it was just so great?
I think when Coulter, our first child was born, it was almost like it just changed me like that.
And both
it was
of
weird.
Us, both of us, because yeah, I
she,
was.
She went into full rejection.
Yeah.
And I was kind of strange.
Motherhood did not come real natural for me.
You know what? Some people struggle with that.
The hospital, she was holding him like this.
He was way better with him than I was.
Oh. Yeah. Okay. What's the nicest thing anyone has ever done for you?
There's been a lot of nice things that people have done for us. I think probably most recently that really sticks out was we have a Starbucks right down the street from us. And I was at the hospital in Oklahoma City with Stan. And I was sitting in the waiting room with, I had such a fantastic support group. I had probably no less than 20, 25 people with me at all times. Anyway, it was like 7 o'clock in the morning, and the manager of our Starbucks from here in Edmond drove all the way down to that hospital, which is enormous, and found me and brought me. He asked the guys that were working, they said, does anybody know Susan's, how she likes her coffee? And this kid said, yeah, I do, and fixed it, and he drove it all the way down there, tracked me down the hospital, and brought me coffee.
That is so thoughtful.
All the way.
Oh,
he's got a thing for it.
Yeah, nobody does good deeds like that for no reason, Susan.
Here I was, man, taking advantage of me laying in the hospital.
Okay, so if you guys could have dinner with any three people dead or alive, who would you choose?
Yeah, that's is where you he will. See, I'm not a history person.
I went right there, man.
I didn't even think of, you know, I heard from them.
I said, like 2 seconds. Abraham Lincoln, John Kennedy, Elvis Presley.
John Candy?
No, John Kennedy. No, John Kennedy. John F. And Elvis Presley. Yeah,
I'd love to have dinner with him too. Yeah. The young Elvis Presley, not the old fat one.
No. Yeah. No, no. Yeah.
How is being grandparents changed you guys?
Ooh.
I heard it's a big change.
It's
amazing. Yesterday, we've been meeting on Sunday afternoons since this whole thing started here at the farm, and we cook out, but we stay far apart. You know, Lang is a nurse, so she's really tried to stay away from us. But at least outside here, we're able to at least eat together, you know, spaced out far enough, be it safely. And yesterday was the first time that I got to hold my grandson, and it was the first time I got to hold him in two months, he went in the hospital. Yeah. And he just grabbed my little neck, you know.
Okay, so how would your enemy describe you in three words?
I don't have any enemy. He's got a lot.
I don't know.
There was one at Nationals what did he say he called you?
Called me a pompous ass.
Oh, there's two words. Okay. Yeah. What's the weirdest thing Susan does?
Nothing.
Yeah, that's right. Nothing.
Perfect.
She's got a phobia about leaving a hat on the bed or...
Yeah, I'm very superstitious.
Or wearing yellow at a horse show.
Or wearing yellow at any time.
Why? I never heard about that. You can't wear yellow?
If we walk to the arena with a horse and that horse did well in his first class... We can't go another way. We have to go that way.
They use the same stall in the bathroom, that same toilet every time. I will be the, there'll be one person in the bathroom and if they're in that one, I will wait till they're done to use that one.
Nothing wrong with her. Nothing wrong with her, Alice, at all.
All right. Now, you guys, what would you want to be remembered for? If you, you know, had to pick one thing that you would want people to remember you for, what would that be?
Tried to help people.
Really?
This is me. Yeah. Not trying to help people.
Yeah. And he does help a lot of people. I will say that. Yeah. And a lot of times that people know people never know about that I don't know. I can usually find out by accident. But yeah, he does do a lot of that.
Well, I think that's, you know something? I mean, you can, sounds silly, but you can be a taker or you can be a contributor. I'd rather be a contributor.
See, that's sportsmanship award thing.
That's why you guys work. You're a yin and a yang. It's perfect. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know what? I can't wait to see you guys at horse shows soon. I hope to see you soon.
I know.
I really want to. I mean, it sounds like June is very promising, and Lexington's definitely happening in July. I think the Nationals, our Youth Nationals, going to happen in July as well.
That's going to take place, yeah. Hopefully.
Are you coming to Vegas?
I'll be there, baby.
We're doing Vegas.
Good. See, yeah. I tell you, if there's a horse show, I'll walk there in my bare feet. I swear to God, if I have to. Okay? I will be at any horse show. There might be three of me running around. Who knows? Yeah. You guys, I love you both to pieces. You're fantastic. I want to thank you so much for being here with us today, for Cinco de Drinco.
Yeah,
cheers.
Yeah.
Cheers to you both.
Cheers.
Adios mio. I cannot wait to see those two at a show soon. Now, don't forget to tune in next week. But in the meantime, happy Cinco de Drinco. But be sure to drinko responsibly. Hasta luego!